does long-term drought affect our trees? We get lots of rainfall here and there, but these days, the summers are much longer, hotter, and drier. And even sporadic rainfall, especially when showers are light, isn't enough to sustain most plants. Trees may show no symptoms of ill health for years, then die seemingly overnight. But long-term drought takes its toll, silently leading to secondary and often tertiary issues. Borer infestation is one good example. These insects don't invade unless a tree is already unhealthy and declining. Valerie Luna recently got in touch about her tree, which has borer damage. But as we can see from other symptoms, like the black, decaying bark at the tree's base, which indicates that the tree was planted too deeply and is staying too wet on the trunk, it's also likely not getting enough water out of the drip line where it needs. These were the original issues, so you should always check with a certified arborist to be sure about the actual cause of decline prior to acting what you think it might be. And what about over-pruned trees that don't look great but sprout a lot of leaves that stay closely attached to larger branches rather than expanding on newly formed side branches as usual? Certified arborist Vincent DeBrock from Heritage Tree Care tells us this. Over-pruning reduces too much foliage, which in turn severely limits the tree's capacity to produce energy through photosynthesis, which then forces the tree to draw from reserved carbohydrates and produce reactive growth, commonly known as suckering or water sprouts. If this growth is removed repeatedly for aesthetic reasons, it tends to weaken the tree even more, eventually causing dieback in the top of the tree and exposing younger bark tissue to sun scald. From spring, near the woodlands in Houston, Brennan Romney's garden backs up to a retention pond, so they spot all kinds of wildlife. He's taught his young daughter how to identify and even hold non-venomous snakes like mud snake and rough green snake. She knows the difference between non-venomous milk snake and its harmful look-alike coral snake. She can also spot a venomous copperhead and a black widow spider. But they also find ox beetles, often called rhinoceros beetles for their huge size. These are harmless insects, and their huge larvae eat decomposing matter, so you'll sometimes see them in your compost pile. And in the family's pesticide-free garden, they've got praying mantises, which delight every child I've ever met. Brennan tells us, one of the neat things about creating a habitat with native plants is watching the animals that come along with it. I've learned that each creature, even the scary ones, serve a purpose to sustain a healthy ecosystem. We'd love to hear from you. Click on centraltexasgardener.org to send us your questions, pictures, and stories.